Thank the organizers for allowing me to make this presentation. I must say that I literally barged into the session. And why am I here? I think as a mental health professional, what am I doing in an endocrine conference? It's a question that, in fact, many of my colleagues also ask, what are you going to do there and talk? But I think it's a very important issue that has recently been bothering the daylights out of me. Just to give you a couple of case scenarios. Female, 57, who suddenly just dropped dead. And I had no clue why this was happening. She was non-compliant to screening for metabolic comorbidities. We could never get an ECG done. We could never get her lab sampling done. She was obese, had a sedentary lifestyle. And there was, of course, increased intake of food. She was on olanzapine, which increases appetite. And the compliance to psychiatric medication was definitely ensured by the family. Naturally, when she doesn't take her psychiatric medication, they're the ones who were facing the backlash. Male, 42, bipolar affective disorder, type 2 diabetes, hypertension, adherence to all conditions, all medical conditions, including bipolar, question mark. We didn't know. But then I knew that there was a lot of comorbidity there, and it actually raised a lot more questions in my mind rather than giving me, answers. I know I've been referring them to physicians, trying to, manage the medications and all, but it was a huge challenge. So what are my travails? I'm actually dealing not just with primary psychiatric condition, I'm dealing with psychiatric comorbidities, because psychiatry is one condition where we're still debating on the categories of definitions and so on. And then I have a huge list of physical comorbidities, particularly non-communicable diseases, which are a big bane in the life of a psychiatrist. We all know that cardiovascular diseases, respiratory diseases, diabetes, cancers and injuries are chronic diseases, and they're the leading causes of death and disability. The burden is going to increase over the next 25 years. Chronic illnesses account for about 60% of all-cause death in the world. Lifespan, when you this is like in the general population, but when you look at people with serious mental disorders, they live much less, they have a much less lifespan than people with than the general population, and much of this death is because of physical illnesses. For a long time, psychiatrists used to think that suicide is the major cause of death for major cause of mortality amongst persons with serious mental disorders. But now there's a lot of meta-analysis which has shown that it's more physical illnesses that cause mortality. And there is a lot of evidence which says that prevalence of DM, hypertension, CAD, stroke, infectious diseases is all higher in the amongst the mentally ill people than the general population. Let's look at what the Indian studies do. Very, very little. Very few Indian studies which looked at specifically the mentally ill population. I've been fortunate to be part of a number of studies which looked at, of course, my area of expertise is schizophrenia, so I have worked on metabolic syndrome and schizophrenia, and we've shown that metabolic syndrome, in fact, there is prevalence of metabolic syndrome even amongst people who are completely untreated. When you look at the untreated population, you find metabolic syndrome in them. And so the question mark is, why? Is there a common pathogenesis there? Prevalence of diabetes and impaired glucose tolerance in schizophrenia was seen to be 2 to 4 times that of the general population. This was part of the CURES study, where one subsample was the schizophrenia population. And of course, there's very limited literature on specific conditions like mental illnesses and diabetes, or mental illnesses and hypertension or cardiovascular risk and so on. But then, so I mean, this is something that I've been working on for many years now. And we've had potential, just to highlight on a potential causes, I'm sure you've heard about all this in the last few, in the last couple of days, this should have come across, come on again and again. But if you look at the group of persons with mental illnesses, in the individual, there's more more prevalence of lack of exercise, obesity, alcohol misuse, smoking, unemployment is a lot more amongst persons with mental illness than in the general population. Then of course we do our bit as psychiatrists in contributing through the use of medication. The evidence base for the value of medication is quite well known. Number of studies which have shown better outcomes using medications, and therefore so naturally it's the easy way out. We try and use a lot of especially second generation antipsychotics like olanzapine, clozapine. The outcomes of psychiatric illnesses is wonderful. I mean, it's remarkable when you see people go back to work, go back to functioning, their hallucinations come down, their delusions come down. It's remarkable, it's very satisfying. But what am I doing in addition? I'm causing weight gain, I'm causing increased cardiovascular risk, and that's actually pretty bothersome. Why? It's bothersome because our patients don't report. They don't report chest pain. They are not compliant to doing their labs regularly. Families say it's very costly, you know, to go take them to the lab to do a blood test, and you know, patient is not wanting to do a fasting blood sample. Some reason or the other, blood tests are not done. So we do not screen, and therefore we land up with situations where they come to us fairly late in the stage of diabetes or a cardiovascular risk. And then you look at the health systems. I mean, while I did take a little blame for the prevalence of NCDs amongst persons with serious mental illness, I would also like to point out that the health services itself could be contributing to this. How is that? There is a fragmentation of the services in terms of mental health care and care for physical health. Here, I've used the term primary care, but I mean care of physical. It's not really, it's like totally de-linked from each other. There's a difference in care that patients with mental illness receive for their physical health in terms of access, in terms of utilization, and in terms of quality of care. Here, I am going to be a little provocative in the sense that I have had patients who have not been seen by a physician simply because they'll say, go back to your psychiatrist. Go back to your psychiatrist will deal with it. Well, I'm not really equipped to treat with diabetes or treat peripheral neuropathy if they come with complications. So what am I going to do? I mean, I must say this as a case example where there was a person who was under treatment with me for schizophrenia, had diabetic retinopathy, but at that time he said, "Kannu sariya theriyala, I'm not able to see properly." I send him to the physician, to the ophthalmologist. He comes back promptly to me and saying, the doctor said, go back to your doctor, go back to your psychiatrist, I think it is functional. Right? This is one instance. I'm apologizing for being a little provocative here, but this is very common. I can cite innumerable examples of where persons with mental illness do not get adequate care from my physician colleagues or from my other colleagues. Now, so what did I do? I decided that, well, I have to learn about these conditions. So I did some learning on diabetes. I did some learning on hypertension management and so on. And I'm happy to say that, yes, today I'm a little better equipped to at least look out for these problems and at least make sure that I convince my patients and their families to go and seek help adequately. Now, of course, I also got into trouble with my own colleagues because I did this. I said, a busy psychiatric OPD is not equipped to deal with NCDs. So you please don't get this brilliant brainwave that psychiatrists have also to treat diabetes and hypertension because of XYZ reasons. So then comes to the, where does this leave us? It leaves us screening processes for the presence of physical illnesses in SMD. Lifestyle factors are relatively easy to measure. I mean, all you have to do is to ask for a detailed question. The first speaker was talking, very emphatically talked about, taking a detailed history. And I will like to reiterate that the same is true for anybody, even people with mental illnesses. But then, do we really do it as a part of our assessments? There is a lacuna, and that is something that needs corrected. Lifestyle factors need to be evaluated. Baseline testings for numerous important physical parameters, simple height, weight, BMI, you know, waist circumferences. These are things that can actually be done even in a busy OPD. And that is something that, and this is like global data, it's not just from India. People with SMD are less likely to receive standard levels of care than care for most of these diseases. This is again a repeat of what I told you earlier. So what did we do? I said, okay, I'm talking so much about screening for mental health, so why don't we embark on a study? So we did, we tried to look for these physical comorbidities in our own OPD, and we tried to see if there was any association with, you know, other kind of demographic, social, demographic and clinical factors. It was a cross-sectional observational study done in July to November 2017. All adults were recruited with any psychiatric illnesses, not specifically serious mental disorders, and they were being treated at SCARF. There was a survey which was developed on the basis of the WHO stepwise approach to surveillance, and patients were interviewed in the local language. We found that 15% of the population had diabetes, which was being currently treated, and it included people who were currently treated as well as picked up, you know, at that point in time. There was about 8.7% of them had hypertension. This was the first ever time a survey like this has been done, and so these figures are fairly recent. In standardized, the values are comparable across the globe where you do find similar figures. What are the factors associated with the presence of diabetes, significant factors I mean? Comorbid hypertension, family history of diabetes and hypertension, and a psychiatric illness of greater than or equal to 5 years. Majority of the patients with diabetes were diagnosed with schizophrenia, but then that's not a very thing because our institution treats largely schizophrenia patients. Patients with only diabetes but not hypertension were taking one or more, there was polypharmacy happening, and that was seen amongst patients with diabetes. And there was no association with the number of antipsychotics prescribed and the diabetes status. This is another issue that has been a big problem, that is non-adherence to treatment. Non-adherence occurs across all illnesses. That is something that is quite well known. And in developing countries, of course, rate of adherence is even lower. Amongst persons with serious mental illness, there are several factors which determine non-adherence: social isolation, stigma, comorbid substance use, effect of symptoms, domains on the adherence, lack of insight, depression, cognitive impairment, and of course the level of non-adherence is pretty underestimated even by clinicians. So what do we do here? Co-managing the comorbidity is, I think, the integral part of management. We have to work together to deal with this problem. And I would like to particularly reiterate this, because every time, you know, there is a person with schizophrenia who has to be given olanzapine because he's not responding to anything else, I know that his HbA1c is going to go up. I would need help in managing this kind of a condition. And therefore, a series of PLOS articles in 2013 has demonstrated that the role of the primary care, integrating this whole management of mental health problems and chronic diseases, is extremely feasible at the level of the primary care. So let's look at what is the role of screening. I think the role of screening is, it's work in progress. It has to happen at every time you see the patient. This kind of a screening has to happen. Baseline history at review is extremely critical of early signs and symptoms of any NCD. of risk. See, one of the things that we have noticed is people say with, you know, our patients don't report pain, whether it's peripheral neuropathy or whether it's chest pain, they do not report it, and sometimes we have to ask for this information, and that's why a detailed history becomes extremely important. Then of risk factors, smoking, excess, lack of exercise, the diet that they take, this is again a question that we do need to ask at every review, and I'm sure when you're seeing patients every month, this is not something that can be left alone. And physical examination becomes a mandatory part of the screening. Height, weight, waist circumference, BP, at least 3 monthly, preferably every visit, documentation is critical. And as is defined by various guidelines, you have to do the blood sugar, the lipids, and the renal parameters so that we pick up, identify the cases early. We are able to make adequate referral and manage it. And I think another important part is follow up on the management. I mean, it's mandatory that, I mean, I feel it's very important that both the psychiatrist and the physician should really ask for the entire prescription and not just the prescription of their specialty alone. It's quite common. I mean, I would say, okay, olanzapine. I'll just write olanzapine. I'm not going to write your the amount of insulin that you're going to take or the antihypertensives that you're going to be on. So that's something that I've learned we cannot avoid and have to look at the total prescription of the person. And I would urge every physician to do that to your patients with psychiatric conditions that they are. You also take a look at what is the kind of co-prescription that the person is getting. So what are our tasks? I think the tasks for the mental health professionals, just to reiterate it, I don't think repeating this any number of times is not going to be enough. Screening, adequate referral, educating. I mean, it's sometimes, you know, we forget that the person is a human being and not just a person with a diagnosis. And therefore, it's important for us to, you know, talk to people about, I mean, I make it a practice that I will talk to them about hypertension, diabetes, consequences, etc. And so that's something that the mental health professionals have to do. And of course, as I said earlier, follow up on the management of the metabolic problems. And so what is the role of the physician? I think if we can recognize the challenges in co-managing, it becomes very, very, it will really add value to the patient's management. And then I urge all of my physician colleagues here that let's have a dialogue. Let's have a dialogue with our patient, and please have a dialogue with mental health professionals also on the management of these conditions, because I think it's together, this is one area where together we have to do our best for the serious mentally ill patient who is under treatment for an NCD. Thank you.
Schizophrenia is, at least what we see, is quite rare, but depression is very prevalent among diabetics. So how do you propose that, whether we should refer all these cases or whether we should do a depression scale questionnaire and then pick up the cases in an outpatient, or can we start antidepressants on our own?
Yeah. So, yes, I mean, that's one area that requires a little bit of attention. Yes, depression is quite common, and the comorbidity is both ways, right? You see people who are not responding to, you know, the medical conditions because of depression. Depression can be comorbid with the physical disorder, or you can see persons with depression coming up with. To answer your second question first, can you start antidepressants? Why not? You are a person with a basic medical knowledge, although I know our MBBS does not cover so much of anti-psychotropic pharmacology. We write an answer in the paper, but that's it. That's where it is. But however, one of the things that I would like to reiterate here is there are a lot of advances in the management of depression, And sometimes, you know, we miss out on newer knowledges. So it might be a good idea to discuss with a mental health colleague who could, you know, give you inputs on managing the depression. But referral might help not just for the antidepressant medication, but also for non-pharmacological management, which is very much within our purview in terms of CBT or in terms of psychotherapy and so on. Yes, so this is another condition where definitely, polypharmacy, including antidepressants, becomes the rule of the game. But the person will need active management for both the conditions.
Along the same lines, we did a quick survey in the OP about a couple of years ago. We found that patients who had a good HbA1c below, say, 6.5 or so, did not have depression at all. And those who had poorly controlled diabetes, many of them had depression.
Yes. So, yes, this is another, in fact, many meta-analysis has shown us this, that, so they're not interlinked conditions. They can co-occur. They can be comorbid conditions, but need one condition, presence of one need not influence the presence of the other condition. So people with a good HbA1c are probably having a good lifestyle, which in itself can determine their mood state. Right? I mean, the HbA1c is not just under control because of, they're also having exercise schedules, they're also having a good diet plan and so on, and that may be actually influencing their mood state. And so I'm really not surprised when good HbA1c, no depression. People, on the other hand, a person with poorly controlled the diabetes can definitely, maybe the lifestyle may be contributing, you know, may either be the resultant of the uncontrolled diabetes or could be causing the uncontrolled diabetes. So they probably need to be co-managed.
My problem is, already the diabetics are obese. When you give antidepressants for the diabetes, they become more obese and obese. I have seen more than 8 kilos increase in with the antidepressant drugs. Let me know, what is the least obesity drug in antidepressant?
Actually, antidepressants per se don't cause so much of weight gain as do antipsychotics, right?
Yeah, that's
SSR, amongst the SSRIs, sorry. Fluoxetine is a good drug which does not cause so much of weight gain. Sertraline definitely causes a lot of weight gain. And there are some newer molecules now, like lurasidone, which is like both antidepressant, antipsychotic, which the industry claims that it doesn't cause much of weight, but then we've got to wait and watch over time.
The
to see.
US textbooks always refer the venlafaxine is a best yes. drug for a diabetic patient with the depression. What's that?
Actually, that's what the initial studies showed, but then over a period of time, meta-analysis doesn't tell you that. And say that there is equi-response to most of the antidepressants. But you can use either a venlafaxine or a sertraline, which are much better response than the other drugs. The difference is not very, very marked.
Thank you very much, sir. That was an excellent talk. Can I request Dr. Girija Madam to present the memento to Dr. Padmavati Madam? Can I request Dr. Vijay Bhaskar, sir, to present the memento to Dr. Girija Madam? Over and above, I will cut it out.